before we start, welcome. I think it's tremendous to follow on last night. I've never been to a medical conference where hymns are sung, in fact there were two. I think it was just fabulous. I saw my wife wipe a tear from the corner of her eye. The only time she ever does that is when she sees an affair to remember. At any rate, we should start the morning by paying our respects to the traditional owners. The Awabakal people and the Wurrumai people we saw last night, they welcomed us into our land, and they're just amazing, generous people, considering we don't return that in the same way. Anyway, our session this morning will be myself, and we'd like to try to systematise and bring a proper response to this Aboriginal epidemic, which is unrecognised largely by government throughout Australia. I may be followed by Rob Eisenberg, and he might give you some special insights into the difficulties ENTs may face in trying to help. Stephen O'Leary may be second, it just depends whether Rob gets here on time. And Stephen's going to be talking about microbiome, I think, and genetics. And then Mahmoud Boutra is going to talk about the genetics of ear disease. So we'll hopefully we'll keep on time. So I'll just turn this on, okay. There you go. So I'm going to talk about trying to get a rational national Aboriginal ear disease program. We actually take on this epidemic properly in a scientific way and basically hold ourselves and the jurisdictions to account if we aren't staying up with the benchmarks set by other people and other jurisdictions. As Kelvin said, I'm an ENT surgeon. I've got the grey hair. I'm president of our ENT society. I'll be that for a couple of years. I've been involved with deadly ears from its inception, and I'm a seagull. I've been dropping in, making a loud noise, and probably leaving a mess behind twice a year for now 30 years at Sherbrooke Aboriginal Community, amongst other things. So there I am, holding a crab up. I thought it was okay, it was safe to... The river behind there is the river right next to Edward River, Crocodile Farm at Pomperow. I thought crocodiles would just kind of idle up, and you'd see them coming a mile away, and it was safe to put your hand in the water and fish. So, stupid. I was at the tail end of the Aboriginal Hearing Conservation Project, which John Stewart helped set up with Jerry McCafferty and Neil Lewis in Queensland. At that stage, we were going out and seeing the kids and sending off to Cairns to be put on the waiting list where they never, ever, ever were seen. I became a consultant at the Royal Children's in 1987, and I took over going to Sherbrooke because Tony Candy, who was one of the original doctors with Jerry McCafferty, he passed it on. In 1999-2001, we set up the Ear Outreach Project, which is basically ENT surgery to Cape York. Judith Boswell ran the project for a couple of years, and it was a really, really good project. It was a pilot study. We got an amazingly good review from the assessors from New South Wales. The money still stopped. Pilot projects are a waste of time. They build up enthusiasm in people and get your knees cut off when the pilot money is over. You want to be within the organisation. So deadly ears started up in 2004-05, and we're doing some surgery in our communities. Things started doing surgery within Sherbrooke itself, rather just going and collecting outpatients to come to have their surgery if they need it at Royal Children's Hospital. And the reason is only one in three Aboriginal people from remote areas seem to be able to have the wherewithal, the money, the enthusiasm. Other people look after, there's sometimes six or eight kids they've got to look after while they're away. For us, a 1 hour trip for them in public transport is 3+ hours. It's a night over in Brisbane, and it's very, very difficult to get things done. And also been involved with telehealth. Australia is many countries in one. Legally, we're actually six separate states, aren't we? We're like the states of Europe, which are combined to the Commonwealth, and somehow the powers of those states have been ceded to the Commonwealth. We've got multiple race, religions and cultures, as we all know. Multiple health regions and administrations who all have their own ideas about what should be done. I'll call myself middle-aged still, as a middle-aged white bloke, I don't see racial discord, but I don't live with it like many people in this room do. It's there, but it's not terribly, terribly violent, as is a lot of places. Australian Aboriginals are the most disadvantaged people in our country. 100 languages, and they come from a wide variety of environments which can impact on ear disease. So that's my phone, and I'm sorry it sounds like that, I'm watching. Aboriginal ear disease, as we know, is very common. I'm not quite sure what the incidence is, it depends on what your definition is, but it's extraordinarily high. The association of deafness and absence of language delay is well known, otherwise there would be hearing assessments done in neonates. You wouldn't be spending $5-6 million in Queensland trying to find the kids getting the cochlear implants done the first year. But somehow the conductive deafnesses can be ignored. We know there's low levels of Aboriginal education attainment. Truancy and leaving school with relative illiteracy is common. This doesn't always work. Alcohol, ice, petrol abuse is common. They can be signs of feelings of hopelessness, nothing to do in the communities. You can't leave the communities because you can't get a job. Can you read the road signs and the timetables of the public transport? Sorry, I'm trying to press it.
Pointed that way.
Just there, thank you. I've just lost it. Suicide, domestic violence is very common, as we know. I'm still okay. High rates of incarceration. Still turning yourself off. High rates of deafness in inmates, although we're not quite sure what the percentage is. Independent studies have been done in Queensland with deadly ears, South Australia with Boys Town. My brother actually was head of Boys Town when that was done. The Northern Territory and in Western Australia. We know it's the truth. The images were just terrible. There's obviously two sides to the story. You would hear that and it's going to be a mud fight in the Northern Territory over those images. And nothing much is going to happen from it, I don't think. My last slide. It's common apparently to find intelligent people in youth detention, but you don't find well-educated ones. Hopefully something good can come out of the Northern Territory, out of what we've seen in those terrible images, and something you know about the incarceration rate and the poor education of Aboriginal people, which can be partly slated back at least to the deafness. The body politic, the health bureaucracy, and the general public don't know of this ear disease, they tend to turn a blind eye to it. Do we need to do better? As a country, are we doing it well? Well, Queensland has deadly ears, and I think it does it really very, very well, but it doesn't half the state. There's nothing in the west and south. Some of the ENTs in Toowoomba want that to change. The CAPE, the program coming out of Cairns, has had lots of issues and nothing much has been done now for 2 or 3 years. The Northern Territory has tremendous stuff with the Menzies School, as Western Australia does with the Telethon group. Hemi Patel and his colleagues, one or two, go out 15 to 16 weeks a year. If Hemi gets sick, what are you going to do? He's almost irreplaceable. The ENT surgeon in Alice Springs, who did a fair bit of that work, now lives in Port Macquarie. Nothing's happening. Harvey Coates and Francis Lanigan do a great job in Western Australia, but their other ENTs go out, and what are they doing? And what proportion of the communities actually see an ENT surgeon? I don't know. South Australia, it's like the APYs don't exist. It's another state. There are two young ENT surgeons go up there, I've got some good mates in South Australia who are involved in Rotary and World Leprosy and Malaria and all this kind of stuff. They do nothing for Aboriginal ear disease and ABY. New South Wales, there's a number of great guys go out there. They've been doing it for many, many years. But Rob Eisenberg, who I talked to this morning about the difficulties he's had of trying to go to a community in New South Wales, he's having roadblocks put in front of him by jurisdiction, by health department. I don't know what's happening in Tasmania and Victoria, but down there it's less than 2 hours' drive to an ENT surgeon. With an ENT surgeon, all becomes audiology and speech pathology and everything else. But I don't know the state of urban Aboriginal ear disease. Like most of this community here, don't either. Is every health region pulling their weight? No, obviously not. Are ENT surgical specialists available? Yes. When Kathy Curry came to the Australian ENT Society meeting in Perth in 2006, asking for volunteers to go to the Northern Territory for the intervention, I said, well, she came up and she asked me. And I said, well, Kathy, just stand over there at the start of the meeting. I went to the front of the room and said, look, Kathy Curry wants people to volunteer to be there at morning tea. If you want to go over and tell her who you are. She had a pad and pencil. The line was over 100 long. They had a half an hour to go and do a pee and have a cup of tea. And she could only write 45 names and telephone numbers in that half hour. Intervention must be evidence-based and cost-effective, and that's not just the ENT interventions, but all the interventions we all like to do in this room. What do we need? We need one voice. We need people to go to say, what should we do? Closing the gap, where are the ears? Closing the gap's all about chronic disease. Well, surely ear disease is chronic disease. It's about decreased life expectancy. Well, surely an uneducated person who ends up largely illiterate, unemployed and impoverished, where you know, suicide and substance abuse and violence become just about the norm, they do have shortened lives. Obama's talking about putting a man on the moon against cancer. Well, now with head neck cancer, there's all these $100,000 a year drugs available for people who went through their life in about 30 or 40% for a year or 10, we just don't know. But there's a big push to cure cancer, it's coming. We need a national push for Aboriginal ear disease. That could be the voice for the housing and water access issues. We need to work closely with education because we're partners in this. We need benchmarks and KPIs, including the people who fund it or who won't fund it. We need to harvest the ENTs and harvest their goodwill, they're there. There's 400 of them in the country, and 100 of them will do this work. So a national ear disease program needs to be based somewhere, but the states must still pay and act. Nobody should feel threatened, except maybe these people. As a Queenslander, I've got chips on both my shoulders, and they're called Sydney on one side and Melbourne on the other. Some things do happen outside Sydney and Melbourne. I think most of the people in this audience recognise that. There could be some interjurisdictional, interstate rivalries. And would the various interest and professional groups work together? I believe they would. But will the administrators, the politicians, the people who pay for it? We're going to have a national Indigenous ear disease program. Here are my thoughts. I think it should be based in Newcastle. Why Newcastle? Newcastle doesn't threaten anybody. The states, the jurisdictions, can hand it over to a voice. It should also be state-based, so the states are still paying. It needs a national director with administration staff, but so does every state. They can just oversee and KPI and give encouragement. It needs a national medical or clinical director. Probably it should be a paid part-time position because jurisdictions don't appreciate volunteers. They're a pest. You need a board of advice, which will include the groups which are widely represented in this audience. Each state needs its own structure and actually according to what they believe their needs are. Now, personally, I think a formal structure a la Delhi is the best, but other states and people may very well disagree. The media, the government needs a place to go to, an organisation, and probably a spokesman. So we need a sustainable champion organisation, we've got to look after Kelvin. We can't kill him. At the same time, he's a bloody good spokesman. Thanks very much. So